mother. I stand in awe of all I see, of all the things you have created, and still you choose to think of me. And who am I that you should suffer? This is my offering, dear Lord. This is my offering to you, God. I will give you my life, for it's all I have to give, because you gave your life for me. Stand before you at this altar. So many have given you more. I may not have much I can give you, yet what I have is truly yours. This is my
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Real Tree Church. Great to see so many sitting here that I haven't seen for weeks, months. Special welcome to those that are joining us online as well. Thank you for tuning in as we consider God's word for us. There are some announcements in the bulletin for you to take a look at. If you are visiting, I would really appreciate if you'd tear off that sidebar, fill that in. Let us know that you're here. If you have prayer concerns, please do the same thing. Pastor Sean and I will take special note of those, be praying for you. The only thing that I don't see in the announcements is our Saturday morning class has resumed meeting face-to-face as well as Zoom. So if you're interested in that, we're studying the book of Nehemiah, and you're welcome to attend. That starts at 8:30 on Saturday morning. Psalm this morning is Psalm 28, a psalm of David, a psalm that should speak to many of us as we consider what he has written for us. Let's read that now. Please join me. Psalm 28, the Lord is my strength and my shield. To you, O Lord, I call, my rock, be not deaf to me, lest if you be silent to me, I become like those who go down to the pit. Hear the voice of my pleas for mercy when I cry to you for help. When I lift up my hands toward your most holy sanctuary. Do not drag me off with the wicked, with the workers of evil, who speak peace with their neighbors while evil is in their hearts. Give to them according to their work and according to the evil of their deeds. Give to them according to the work of their hands. Render them their due reward. Because they do not regard the works of the Lord or the works of his hands, he will tear them down and build them up no more. Blessed be the Lord, for he has heard the voice of my pleas for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts, and I am helped. My heart exults, and with my the Lord is the strength of his people. He is the saving refuge of his anointed. O save your people and bless your heritage. Be their shepherd and carry them forever. Please join me in prayer. Father, we come from a week of trials, frustrations, and distractions of enemies of all sorts. We too have felt the anger and frustration that David had for those against him. Yet once we too were considered enemies of yours because of our sinfulness. In many ways, Lord, we deserve the very judgment being called down by David on his enemies in this psalm. We pray that your Spirit convict us of those things that we have set between us, hindering a strong, reliant relationship with you. We pray that rather than being a prisoner of our sin, may we be taken captive and be a prisoner for spreading the gospel message and furthering your kingdom. May our hearts be lifted as we see the morning you've created and your renewed mercies it brings. Enjoy the fellowship of worshiping you in spirit and in truth, and fully strive to know your unfathomable love for us as revealed in your word. Now settle our hearts and minds as we focus on you and as we seek your face. May our worship be a fragrant offering as we raise our voices in praise. May we, in our thoughts, our words, and our deeds today and beyond, bring glory to your name. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen.
Feel free to stand and worship with us.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. And there's a place where streams of grace flows deep and wide, where all the love
I'm in awe of you.
us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, your face. Oh God of Jacob, give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Bend our knees, O Spirit, come make us humble. So Sean's traveling, and we start practicing this. I'll fly away, and he's like, I want to play that with you guys.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Heavenly Father, someday, and it may be soon, you will return. You will return to shouts of acclamation. Father, we look forward to that day. We yearn for that day. May we be prepared for that day. But Father, until that time, I pray that we continue to search your word, be diligent in our relationship with you, be faithful in what you've called us to. Father, as we consider Paul's word to the Ephesians, may we understand your text as another incarnation of who you are, your truth for us. Father, the spirit that drove Paul to write these words, I pray that that same spirit work in us as we seek to not only interpret it, but to apply it to our lives. Father, thank you for this gift. Again, may our worship be pleasing to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
All right, I want to start with a thought this morning around Ephesians. And a lot of what we're going to be talking about, so Paul breaks the book up in two sections. One is around, you know, what it is, what's all the doctrine surrounding good biblical teaching and doing church right. But then the second part of Ephesians is broken up in the what is the duty of Christians. So I want you guys to be thinking of this in your heads, and you might have heard this, walk like an Ephesian. Walk like an Ephesian. You guys know what an earworm is? You're welcome. I mean, they wrote a song about it. It is so good to see all your smiling faces. It's good to be out and about. All of those online, you'll see that today is the first day, so if you join us online or are joining us online, you will notice that all the scriptures and all the song lyrics are now a part of the online service. So well done, Steve. He's like, what's this button for? Oh, look at that. Yeah. So you won't have to get that separately in an email. You'll be able to just follow along with the service and the worship music without having to print it all out and have it at the ready. So welcome to the Real Tree Church this morning. What a great day it is to come and learn together and seek the word of our Lord. Today we're going to be looking at specifically Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. So please take your Bibles in hand, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. And while we're doing that, let's prepare our hearts and our minds to hear, to understand, and apply our great Lord's word to our everyday actions. Today is a day to know, truly know, that we are aligned to God's plan. If you're not sure about your walk or your calling, the state of your hearts, today is the day to make the choice of a lifetime, to serve our perfect God. If you haven't made that choice, please listen closely to the living words that he's given us today. And I beg you to consider the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior today, right where you sit. Now is the time, because when we are not certain, how many people feel that things just aren't as certain as they once were? Show of hands, come on. There's an uncertainty in the world, and it has caught its own wildfire. But there's a certainty in our Lord Jesus Christ that separates us from the lack of peace going on in the world. So, before we dig into Scripture, let's talk about the epistle or the letter written to the Ephesians. And as I was studying for this, there was some debate on did Paul really write this? Presumably because there was a style of writing and a vocabulary used by Paul. However, Paul refers to himself twice in the letter. So we're going to go ahead and run with that. So this letter was mostly written, likely, when Colossians, Philemon, Philippians were also written. And it's believed that it was written while Paul was in prison in Rome between 60 and 62. Darcy and I traveled to Ephesus about 10 years ago. And we couldn't get the pictures on. And we traveled there, and talk about a land of tourism now. It's just a land of tourism, and we really, John's buried there, believably. His grave is there. And John cared for Mary, Jesus' mother, there in her home. We drank from her well from our home, toured around Ephesus, and felt like we were never further from God's truth. And we went after the day, we were like, wow, that was really underwhelming. And that was underwhelming because of how they, oh, and we're touring this, and this is this, and or was it our hearts? Were we really there to walk like an Ephesian? Right? Were our hearts and our minds really thinking like it from what Paul had written 2,000 years ago? Or were we getting sucked into the world of, hey, check out Ephesus, it's so cool. Everybody should go. I know some of you guys are, I'm hair challenged compared to Sean, so I know that's new for you guys, so try to stay with me. That's for you, Sean. So the Ephesus church was planted by Paul and Priscilla and Aquila, and they planted a number of churches in that area. And about seven churches were in that area. They're referred to as the Western Asia Minor area. And during the first years of this church plant in Ephesus, the elders went off script, off topic. And we notice in Acts there's places referring to that they were doing things improperly. Paul had to go back and pastor that church for about 3 years. So this letter to the Ephesians could have been in a different letter had Paul not went back to Ephesus and pastored that church and rightly aligned the truth of God to their lives. And then Timothy also stayed for another year and a half. So I didn't read that when I read Ephesians the first time. I thought, wow, these guys really got it together. No, they didn't have it together. They did get it together. And I see a lot of that in our modern church culture, where it's kind of a, hey, we should all figure it out for ourselves. Not what happened in Ephesus. The letter to the Ephesians was likely sent out to the entire area of those churches that Paul helped plant. So let's look at the overarching structure. I mentioned it earlier. The first three chapters are the instruction and the foundational truths of God. The last three chapters define the duty of believing Christians, which was the primary focus of our conversation today. And we should be asking ourselves, how am I living my life? How am I preparing to live my life? Am I doing that as a true follower of Jesus Christ? So let's stand in unity and show our deep respect to the reading of God's holy and true word. Ephesians 4, chapter 1 through 6. Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. This is the inherent, immutable word of the living God. Father, we come to you this morning in gratitude and worship. Lord, we ask that you open up our hearts and our minds to hear your word that would transform us and how we live our lives day to day. And we praise you and we give you the glory in all things. And we pray that your will be done in this church body and in our lives. To you be the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So imagine a world full of true believing Christians. What would the news look like to you? But when you start imagining a world of true believing Christians having a high view of God and a low view of their self in comparison, words that are used by people would build up one another rather than debate and argue and tear down. Actions would also keep people from getting angry over the actions that they use, because their actions would be that of a true believer. Words that would provide not the truth, the truth. I move around a lot. Steve's trying to move me over. Right now. Just can't the camera move? Kidding. But it would provide the truth and a recipe for the way we live our lives. Based on the calling, now notice that in Ephesians it talks about this, on the calling that God has for each and every one of us that truly believe. Notice I said, based on the calling that God has for each and every one of you that truly believe. So let's dig into the actual first verse and ask ourselves, while we're looking at these verses, ask about our own personal ethos, our beliefs tied to our daily actions. Are truly our beliefs actually tied to our actions? Okay? Therefore, transitional word that is showing the shift from the first three chapters of Ephesians discussing doctrine to the next three chapters discussing duty. You guys are probably thinking, great, we're one word in. There's 93 words, 94 words in this, so no, I'm not going to go through every word. But this is an important word, therefore. It's talking about what was being set out as a church in the first three chapters. The next three chapters are going to be talking to us about how we as Christians should act. Therefore, I, Paul, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of your calling with what you have been called. Paul is describing himself as a prisoner of the Lord. That's an interesting word, prisoner of the Lord. In Ephesus, Darcy and I were standing at this, the theater, they call it the theater now, and it was to a woman goddess of Rome, and we're standing there, and the guy says in passing, oh yeah, and over there's the prison where Paul and Peter were jailed. And back to Ethiopia. I mean, it was just kind of this, well, can we go over there? May we walk over there and see that? Because that's pretty amazing. But a prisoner, he's reminding us also of his Christian walk can be costly. And that Paul had paid a considerable personal price because of his obedience to the Lord. That should make us stop and realize the authority with which Paul speaks as a slave to Jesus Christ when writing this. And he says, I implore you, I beg you. Beg. How many people have begged you other than for money? Begged you in your life to maybe make you stop and see something differently. Begging you. I implore you, I beg you to walk in a manner worthy of your calling. To walk is frequently used in the New Testament to refer as your daily conduct, your walk. Daily, not just Sunday mornings, when I'm on my best behavior. I don't know if you guys know me well. Darcy says I'm not nice. I'm very well-mannered. Yeah, but I'm on my very best behavior Sunday morning, but this is a daily calling to walk. We represent the Lord Jesus Christ in our conduct, in our words, in our actions. We're expected to live by standards assigned to all believers following Jesus Christ. If we were to live worthy of our calling, maybe everyone that comes in contact with us would believe things we say, words we speak, actions. Also notice, with which you have been called. You have been called. You have been called to a salvation by the sovereign God of the universe. And Paul is begging you to walk in a manner worthy of that calling. Verse 2, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. That's a mouthful. So we're talking about how to walk worthy in a manner. Hey, let's make a checklist. Who likes checklists? Who loves to live by a to-do list? Well, it would start with humility. Check that box. Chances are you'll move to patience. Check that box. It may show some tolerance for one another. And if you check all those boxes, chances are you would show love. What a concept. To walk like an Ephesian. I really hope you guys, we'll talk about that. So are we truly approaching Christian brothers and sisters in humility towards ourselves with gentleness? Patience, showing tolerance for one another, all of this enveloped in love? If not, being gentle, patient, or tolerant with your brothers and sisters in Christ, are we being sharp, impatient, prideful? I beg you to walk in a worthy manner. Because you have been called, you have been set apart. The word humility, also called lowliness, so there's no word for humility in the Greek or Hebrew words. However, lowliness is a word also used in places when describing humility. And in Greek, the word is tapanophros une. You're going to want to use that. Write that down. You're going to, oh yeah, tapanophros une. Never. You're probably never going to say that again. Which is unique to the New Testament that describes the humble spirit that should mark all believers. If we were in a lineup being charged with being a Christian, would they tell us to step forward? Because that's the Christian right there. Or, oh, I didn't know you were a Christian. Yeah, I've known you for 10 years. I didn't know you were a Christian. How cool. Me too. Would they see your humility? This characteristic of humility and gentleness and patience and tolerance starts with humility. That wasn't an accident for Paul being guided to write that word humility, because the most foundational virtue of a Christian is humility, being humble. In James chapter 4, verse 6, James had written, but he gives a greater grace. Therefore, it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. This is also the quality of a character commanded to us in the first beatitude and describes the noble grace of Jesus Christ. If you're humble, this is a natural outcome to being gentle. Notice that combination. If people are not humble with one another, chances are they're probably not going to be very gentle either. And to be both gentle and humble would find patience. All of this enveloped in love. Unconditional love for one another. A friend of mine texted me this morning, hey, I'm praying for you this morning. I said, thank you, brother. And he responded, we are. We are brothers. and being in relationship with one another, you would find it hard to be in a relationship with somebody that's always impatient, that's always prideful, that's not very gentle with us, right? That'd be hard. That'd be a hard life to live. As true believers, that's our calling, to walk in this worthy manner. Now, verse 3. Being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The indwelling Spirit of Christians should create a unity in spirit to all true believers, something that encompasses this entire congregation of believers and ties godly people together. This bond is love. It should tie us together. We should do life together with that manifest of things on how to treat one another. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 14, it reads, "Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity." Now, verse 4. "There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling." This is a great reference that our one body should emulate the triune God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit as one. God is not referencing them individually. He's talking about the unity of our great God in three persons, unique but separate. We are unique but separate as a body of Christ. So as a body, there's many members in the body, and if your hand's kind of just doing its own thing as the body, chances are people won't want to talk to you a lot. If you just all day, every day, your hand was doing its own thing all day, every day, chances are you're going to want to fix that. You're going to want to see a united body. A body that's complete, that's very, very much like the emulation of Jesus Christ. Gentle and humble and patient and loving. If not, you might be the hand doing something crazy, making other people really kind of, wait a minute, that's different from what we're trying to do here. And then as a body of believers, we would actually go and talk to that hand. Reason with it. Say, come on, let's do this together. And we would respond to it gently, humbly, patient, and in love. Either that or you got to whack the hand off. That doesn't sound fun. Every believer since Pentecost, without distinction, should be of one body in one hope. This hope is for all of us to hear these words. Our hope should be for us to hear these words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Should that be on our hearts and minds? To hear that at the end of our days, at the end of our life, to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant," from our Lord? Well, that goal comes with a lead measure. So I work in a business, and we talk about goals, and we talk about, well, how do you achieve those goals? And we're talking about the goal of a church body today. And there's this interesting book called The Four Disciplines of Execution, How to Execute Against Us. And it starts with, well, have a wildly important goal. The wildly important goal of this church is for every believer to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And now you have two things that happen in that process. There's lead measures and lag measures. Lead measures are, what am I doing to create that outcome? Where lag measures are just kind of a report. So if anyone has ever dieted in their life, probably nobody in this congregation, but if anyone ever has dieted in their life, a lag measure would be to step on a scale. And the scale tells you, it's feedback. It tells you what it reports that information. A lag measure is, well, I diet and I exercise, I eat better, and you know, I had some medical stuff that I took care of, and it did some things for me. And those are lead measures that I change those to have a more predictable lag measure. In Christianity, the lead measures are, and I really want this to sink in for all of us, that it starts with being humble. And that should create a gentleness in us, and that should allow patience and tolerance for one another, and that would all be enveloped in love. Those are the lead measures of making this the goal of one hope in Jesus Christ. You have to remind yourself every day of your calling. Because we are surrounded by some pretty ridiculous noise in our lives. And you have been called by the sovereign God of the entire universe. And you should daily remind yourself that you have been called and being drawn to God and sharing this one hope in unity. Verse 5, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. I believe that the importance of this passage is to remove any confusion that lies in things like universalism. All dogs go to heaven. Everybody gets a free pass. You can believe anything you want to believe, and that's okay. That is not unity, that's confusion. It's chaos. And if you ever ask why so much of the noise that we experience in our lives, it's typically because we're not seeing the unity in things together, clarity in things that ought to be clear. And I have very dear friends that want nothing to do with God, with Jesus. They also know that I have very clear boundaries that that's great. We can disbelieve. You can disbelieve that. I can't do anything to do that other than live a life that you might say, wow, that's different. But I also know that they can't tell me I have to live my life entirely different to meet their needs, to serve their truth. Has the word truth gotten a little chaotic in the last year or two? I have a dear relative, I love her dearly, and she says, well, my truth. And I said, can we talk about that just for a minute? There's either information that leads to a truth, or there's information that you have that allows you to think something, but it may not be an absolute truth. It might be feelings. It might be situational information that you had in your life that you are now compartmentalizing information to create a truth that's absent from facts and evidence. Mark Twain said, facts are stubborn things. Truth should set us apart, and truth will set you free. It's either true or it's not true. When people say, I don't believe all that stuff in the Bible, then please do me a favor. Don't believe anything in the Bible. If you choose to create a truth around the Bible saying, oh, well, this is my truth. This is what I want to believe. Either God is a sovereign God over all things, and that there's not a radical molecule in the universe in sovereignty, or all bets are off. That's a choice for us to stop and trust in our Father God. And if you have that disbelief, you should be praying about the Spirit to actually guide you and give you better information and better discernment on truth. Paul went back to Ephesus because there was, well, here's my truth. Apparently the elders of that time, when after the church plant, they were trying to change what the belief should be in Ephesus at that time. Paul said, well, I got to go back. And pastored that congregation for 3 years. And then Timothy a year and a half more. Because there is no decision on what your truth is. Now, can you have healthy debate and discussion about the Lord and his word? Yes.
Matter of fact, if you can't have a discussion and a debate and learn and be in that opportunity to learn more, then I don't know how tolerant somebody's being of you to actually hear why you believe that and then point to God's word to actually help remedy that thought so we can get back into truth. Because all dogs do not go to heaven. I know you've seen the cartoon. Some of you may have seen the cartoon. It may not be true. We serve the only Lord, the faith, and baptism, all who are baptized showing true conversion of one's outward expression, affirming that they share in a personal faith in Jesus Christ, one Lord. At that time in Ephesus, the Roman gods were quite popular. I need this, so I'm going to pray to this god. Or I need more sunshine, so I'm going to pray to this god. Oh, I need more rain, I'm going to pray to this god. On and on and on. So the messaging of one faith, one Lord, one baptism was very important in getting their truth right. So here we are reading a letter to the Ephesians 2,000 years later. How many lives from Ephesus were changed that those people became true believers of Christ, that here we are 2,000 years later believing this truth in God's word? So imagine the Real Tree Church 2,000 years from now. I think we ought the 2,000-year shed package, right? Something like that, 2,000, 3,000 years. It's made up of the people, because I've been to Ephesus and it's destroyed. The city doesn't exist, hardly at all. There's remnants of that. But we're still talking about the Ephesians because of their unity, of their peace with one another, doing life together, and here we are talking about them. I would love to see 2,000 years later, who wants to have a family someday? Oh, who has a family someday? Or who has? Wouldn't you like that generation to generation to generation know that that started because of a true belief? Because you, as a believing true Christian, you were edifying one another and also admonishing one another when needed, correcting. But you did it out of truth and out of love. Our goal as this body should be that 2,000 years later, believing Christians came from here. Your children's children for generations to come until the day our Lord returns. And that's where we could get writing our own songs, right? Walk like an Ephesian. You guys knew I was going to do something stupid, right? I did, right when Sean said, hey, I'm going to be gone. Do you want to pray? Yeah. Do you want to preach? Yeah, I'll do something stupid. And pretty immediately that walk like an Ephesian kind of got in my brain. And has anyone in this room not heard that song, Walk Like an Egyptian? Anyone? Okay, good. Because I've been in settings where I shared some version of what I thought everybody should know, and they're like, what is he talking about? Last verse, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The all in all. Through all, over all. That's a complete list of the Almighty. Our Almighty God, that's a pretty complete list. There's nowhere, nothing is outside of God's vision, his great depth. There's nothing outside of God's all. And it pains me to think that there's so few that are called that ever grasp how truly great the opportunity really is. Let me repeat that. How many people have been called to our Lord, but they did nothing about it? That makes me sad. That I know they've been called, and they're doing nothing about it. Sean and I were having a great conversation about being called. It took me 20 or 19 years to actually do the work, to say, you know what? Because faith without works is dead, if you read in James. So are you really aligning yourself and putting yourself all in to get to the point of saying, yep, God did the calling, and it took me years to show up. It took me a long time to get to the point of my head to my heart, and it shouldn't take that long. And if you see that in yourself or others, dig in. Make that change. We worship the true living God, the all in all, the great I am. You will come to this church and you will hear the word of God because faith comes by hearing. And if you have that unction, listen on the Lord, act on the need that you have in your heart today, you are called in unity. And be humble. If you can't make the whole checklist, start with just being humble towards one another. Because I'll make you a guarantee, because I've read the Bible too. If you are humble, you will see more gentleness. You will be more patient just by being humble. And it's easy to remind yourself to be humble when you think highly of God. When you have a high view of God, it's pretty easy to put yourself in a position of saying, yep, I am not God. And if you treat everyone with the respect and care and love that they deserve and they want and they need in their lives, there's a law of reciprocity that kind of comes back to you. So if you're finding yourself prideful, impatient, angry, haughty, chances are you might attract people just like that. That they may not deal with you rightly as well. So let's follow the instruction in Ephesians to do that together in unity. Let's pray together. Lord, we bow our heads before you, Father. We ask that you grant us strength according to your riches and your glory, Lord, to be strengthened through the power of the Holy Spirit, that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith, and that we be grounded in love and to know and show others the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, and that we are filled with the fullness of God. Humility, gentleness, patience, unity, and peace. To him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Now, I just got to be honest with you guys. I didn't write that. That's in Ephesians. That's the prayer in Ephesians that I just shared with you. And if you guys really want to dig in, it's 6 chapters. Read that this week. Take a moment and read Ephesians, all 6 chapters, and let it get into your heads and into your hearts. It's quite awesome. Thank you, guys. Let's worship together. You guys want to
jealous for me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us.
is jealous of me. He loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of the sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me.
Loves us so dearly and so greatly that it should penetrate our hearts and our minds to a new place in our lives. So may God, the God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. May the God of peace be with you all. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great week. Go serve your King.